I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show. The Trump administration, the Environmental Protection Agency, within these last hours and days, a decision is made halfway to turn away from the CAFE standards established by the Obama administration's EPA towards an unclear future. However, inside this is a consideration, practical consideration, about what the effect would be of obeying the Obama administration and what we gain by not obeying the Obama administration. Marlo Lewis for the Competitive Enterprise Institute, he is a senior fellow, is here to comment first on this rulemaking. Marlo, good evening to you. The Obama administration set a very high standard. The school marm wanted us at 54.5 miles per gallon by 2025. What would that mean if we were to go all the way to 2025 with that rule? What would that mean for cost and effectiveness and safety for the American consumer, the car buyers? Good evening to you.
Good evening, John. Well, no one knows precisely what these effects would be because those all would have to be sorted out in the marketplace. But some pretty good analyses, for example, a Heritage Foundation study estimates that the 2025 standard would raise the cost of a new vehicle by about $3,400 above what the average vehicle cost in the year 2016. So that's a pretty hefty increase. And the thing to understand, I mean, the important thing to understand here is that vehicle costs have been rising ever since the Obama administration took charge of fuel economy and greenhouse gas emission standards regulation for motor vehicles in 2009. The same Heritage study showed that if we had remained on the baseline trend, which was, believe it or not, a trend toward decreasing motor vehicle prices, that by 2016, vehicles would have cost about $6,800 on average less than they actually did. So all of that increase in cost between 2009 to 2016, the Heritage Foundation acknowledges that there may have been other factors in play, but it looks very suspicious when you have government agencies mandating new expensive technologies and vehicle costs going up instead of going down as they had been for the previous decade.
What were we going to get out of this 54.5 miles per hour? What's the trade-off? Well, how do we gain?
Well, supposedly we gain because we, as a country, consume less fuel. We're less dependent on oil. And supposedly because greenhouse gas emissions, in particular carbon dioxide from the combustion of gasoline, would go down. But if you actually poke into that a little bit, what you find is that these gains are all notional, or they all are in the realm of virtue signaling. According to the Obama administration's own climate model, or it's actually EPA's own climate model, which interestingly is acronymed MAGIC, according to the MAGIC model, the entire suite of Obama administration fuel economy standards from 2012 all the way out to 2025 would avert less than 0.02 of a degree Celsius of global warming by the year 2100. So this is a vanishingly small mitigation of global warming that no one would notice, that probably even in 2100 could not be detected. It would have no impact, especially in the foreseeable future, on things like weather patterns or sea level rise or polar bear populations. But it would cost, according to the agency's own estimates, something like $62 billion for the auto industry, or no, it was more like $200 billion for the auto industry to come into compliance with it. And similarly, with the reductions in fuel, well, those are just a small fraction of the total fuel that Americans buy. But the thing is that back in 2009, the prediction still was that OPEC was going to continue to control the global oil market and that America would be increasingly dependent on oil imports from unstable and unfriendly countries. And we know that thanks to the fracking revolution, that whole big picture has been falsified and swept into the dustbin of history.
There's a suggestion that California, which has extremely stringent rules about CAFE, will challenge the Trump administration. Do you expect that to be successful? Can they carve themselves out? You know, they've done that with sanctuary cities. Can we talk about CAFE sanctuary?
That's very good. I think they will contest this in court. California has made it such a point of pride about being the most environmentally pure jurisdiction in the United States, if not the world. It's almost the only thing that they've got going for them now, even though this very thing it contributes to the rising cost of living in California, which has given the state the highest effective poverty rate of any state in the country. My advice to the my free and unsolicited advice to the Trump administration and Administrator Pruitt is that they embrace the original fuel economy statute of the United States. It's called the Energy Conservation and Policy Act of 1975, and it very clearly says that a state may not adopt or enforce a law or regulation related to fuel economy standards. And California's greenhouse gas emission standards are just de facto fuel economy standards. And California, you see, is always threatening to go its own way if it doesn't get its way. The Obama administration deputized California to play this role so that there would always be this pressure on the federal agencies, the EPA and the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, and on the auto industry to achieve more and more stringent fuel economy standards. But I would argue that California's role in this whole process is unlawful, and that is a legal resource, a legal remedy that no one has really been able to utilize to date. Why? Because the auto industry has been cowed by California and fears to antagonize the California Air Resources Board. The National Auto Dealers Association tried to litigate under the Environmental Policy and Conservation Act and this preemption of state standards, but the Court of Appeals in the District of Columbia decided that the national auto dealers didn't have standing, even though they were clearly injured by regulatory cost increases in motor vehicles that would make it less possible for people to buy cars. They wouldn't be injured because the regulation only applies directly to automakers and not to them. But Administrator Pruitt could very well make a legal case before a court. Or rather, the representatives of the Trump administration could do so from the Justice Department representing Pruitt, could make the case that federal law preempts California from any role in determining fuel economy standards. I hope that's what he does.
Marlo Lewis is a senior fellow at the Competitive Enterprise Institute, elucidating a battle inside the larger war on the administrative state left over from the Obama administration. I'm John Batchelor.